Hi, can you hear me okay?
So I'm Ben Tovar from the University of Notre Dame. And my talk is going to answer a little bit the question that James did, that whether we can do sustainable with our current institutions. And my answer is like, kind of. So what we do in my lab is that usually we have scientists that come and they prepare a small demo of their project in their laptop, and that runs really, really well. But really, the answer they are looking for that, they have to scale. So they have to go to the cloud, a campus cluster grid, so forth. So what we do in my lab is to be this arrow. So we help the scientists to go from this laptop to this nice set of resources. Of course, life is never this easy, and really what happens is that we don't really know where we're going to land, especially in what we focus in my lab, the cooperative computing lab, is opportunistic resources. So from the beginning, our software has to be robust because we don't know where we're going to land. And a single user means many, many computers. So in this sense, our lab doesn't exist in isolation. Yes, our main purpose is to do computer science research, but that comes only from collaborating with people. So we don't invent new problems. Our research problems come from talking with people. And what we do is to develop open source software. So I won't go into the details of what we do with the software, but in terms of sustainable characteristics, two important things that we have is that we don't require permissions or privileges, so everybody can use and install the software. And the software has minimal dependencies, and you can compile it in 1 to 2 minutes. So one of the, or the biggest challenge that we have is that, or we had 2 years ago, was that our lab was composed of one faculty, about 6 PhD students, and 1 to 2 undergrads. This created a challenge because now we had users and now we had to maintain the software. But we have these two poles, right? First, we want the software to work, so we have to be practical. But at the same time, you don't want to enslave your students so that all their imagination dies because they are working on your software. So in these two poles, what we have is we want the students to have flexibility. Mainly, the objective is so they can have novel ideas. But if you have software out, if you have a critical bug, that trumps everything. Right? So what Professor Tain said, which is the director of our lab, well, what we really need is a software engineer. So we get a software engineer, and then people can dedicate to the research part, and then the software engineer can manage this part. One of the biggest issues that we had with the students is that new students know or may know very well how to do script programming, but not system programming, which means garbage collection and stable APIs and all those things are not, we have to teach them. Now, around this time, I applied for the position, and my background is also in research. So this allowed the lab to have some interesting opportunities. I was not only, or I'm only a software engineer, but I also do research. And this turns my job rather into being just a software engineer here. My life is really more as a spring over here. So I support students and also support the size of the research. We have some policies that you will expect. For example, I'm the single committer to the stable branch, and we allow all the crazy to happen in the master branch. But this model is working for us very, very well in the sense that students get trained doing software, and they make sustainable our software by including new features. And on this side, we are stable, and we support our clients. So we are sustainable in the sense of our user scientists can rely on our software. I'm almost out of time. So I will just say that the other half of my job is actually doing research. My salary comes from grant projects. And once in a while, I also serve as a lecturer, which is a model for me to be funded in my position. So if you have any questions, or you can contact me at this address.
Thanks for setting me up. You already know who I am and probably remember my name. I am representing a large group of authors that is has written the manifesto, the Karl Skroner Manifesto on Sustainability Design, which you find on your tables. Unfortunately, I did not have enough copies for every participant, but just take a first look and it can be found online. Now, I want to explain to you what this is about, and I want to start by framing what we mean by sustainability, because I was the devil's advocate raising that question during the discussion. So, we as a group have a general sustainability goal. We want to enable the thriving of human and other life on this planet, and that has more dimensions than just the environmental dimension. That has an economic dimension. Business can take care of that. We are pretty successful in doing that. It has a technical dimension, which I gather is what many people in this workshop are very concerned about, the longevity of systems. Individual sustainability, which means preserving a human over the course of their lifespan, including their education and health and so on. Social sustainability, which is living together as a working society. And last but not least, the environmental factor. Where should I be positioning myself so I don't echo so much? Maybe over here. Okay. Now that is pretty abstract and pretty fluffy. So to operationalize that definition, we need to break it down into what do we want to sustain, for whom, for how long, and at what cost. And in relation to software systems, because some of the reviewers asked me, well, I see environmental sustainability is important, but how does all of that relate to sustaining software? We have software systems or software intensive systems facilitating almost all aspects of our daily lives. And they have a big impact on our behavior. There are three dimensions of effects, or three orders of effects they have. There is the direct effect of using a software system. Let's go with the example of a car sharing system for a minute. A car sharing system like Zipcar in the US has a database back end, and it has some user front ends, predominantly. That's the software part. Perfect. That uses a little bit of energy and a little bit of hardware. OK, impact is not so big. If we look at the user community of that car sharing system and how it enables them to share cars, to call pool, and to change traffic accordingly, that are the enabling effects. And then the third order, that's the systemic long-term effects. Assuming a lot of people use a car sharing system like Zipcar over an extended period of time, that could decrease emissions, that could make air quality better in some regions that are congested, and it could also solve some of the parking space problems we have in inner cities. So therefore, you see, by going through those dimensions and orders of effect, we can see software intensive systems have a big effect on sustainability overall. Therefore, we say we need to take general sustainability into account. Why then a manifesto? Our manifesto does not want to prescribe you in very detailed steps what you need to do. Our manifesto is an invitation to discuss about what is going wrong currently, about what principles might help us to get it right instead, and to start a discussion on sustainability.design.org here in the workshop room, on Twitter, wherever you think is most convenient or most helpful for everybody. What is going wrong? We have identified a number of misperceptions. Inter alia, framing sustainability as only an environmental concern. That can't be right, because the planet, the environment, would do perfectly fine without us humans. Therefore, framing it as environmental concern is not enough. Dismissing sustainability as a distinct research field also doesn't work. It is embedded in any other aspect. And thinking small steps towards sustainability are going to be enough is also not enough. Energy efficiency and improving energy efficiency bit by bit is great, but we need more than that. Now, what we propose are the following principles: that sustainability is a systemic thing, that it's multidisciplinary, that we need to think long term, that it applies to systems and their wider context, and a few more that I don't have time to recite. So what I want to do is take those high-level principles and apply them to what we do in software design, in this room, in this wider community, because all of you are software engineers, and I want your help in that. Thank you.
And Nicola is next, and Abby, we have a seat for you that you can move into after a couple of minutes,
and we'll save time on the transfer. It's right there. Please use these talks to generate some new thinking. Post-it notes, and we'll have an opportunity to post those later.
Okay, cool. Well, hello, my name is Nikolai Simakov, and I'm working at University at Buffalo, and I have a little bit more to the grant presentation. They would like to share with our recent experience in modernizing Titan2D, which is a GeoForce simulation software. So first couple words about what is Titan2D. So it's basically, it is a simulation software which models the granular flows, basically like geological mass flows such as debris, avalanches, and landslides, or the digital elevation models. So this software is used by many geophysicists for the risk assessments of hazards due to this type of debris flows. So here's like illustration, which supposed, well, where's the button? Okay. Well, this is supposed to be the animation, and we're supposed to be a pile of debris which is supposed to slide down. And we're supposed kind of to show you what more intuitively what the software is doing. So basically, one of the key features of this simulational software is that it uses adaptive mesh refinement, which is pretty cool from the numerical point of view, but very difficult to optimize. And of course, it's used MPI for the parallel version. So basically, the first release happened sometime in 2002, 2003. And after that, different fellow geophysicists decided that they want to implement either new physical models or they want to implement a new numerical methods. And instead of adding the new capabilities to the existing software, so here's roughly shown the main branch. So instead of adding new functionality, they simply replace the existing routines here. So now we got kind of codes which are very difficult to merge, because basically the functioning of certain routines was replaced with new models or new numerics. And that was partially done mainly because the original code was using a fixed format for the input formats. So basically a text file where each line specifies a certain parameters. And that's very difficult to, this fixed format is fixed, it's not very flexible. So if you want to introduce a new functionality, it's nearly impossible to maintain back compatibility. And in addition, many parameters were specified during the compilation time. And after all, there is a time pressure. So the geophysicist will try kind of say, oh, I want to try my new model. And if it will work out, then, well, I will think about how to edit properly. And we all knew that temporarily there is nothing more permanent and a temporary. So at the end of the day, now we're having a bunch of different codes, which are very similar and very kind of different because they fork at a different period of times and feature in different physics. And now we want to merge them and have some benefits of different methods cross-pollination. So basically, we want how we can merge them all together. So we decided to reinforce a pretty straightforward code laid out, where like in the bottom, you have like a core data formats, same like similar services, like input, output, numerical methods, physics, etc. So in this way, if we will optimize some routines in the bottom, then our top level methods will automatically be better. And in order to overcome the fixed format, we decided to go with full-scale programmable API. So we implemented two-layer of the Python API. So basically, here we have our low level, which are automatically generated and pretty much reflect the current stage of the C++ API, and the high-level Python API. So the idea is that the high-level API is extremely stable. So we design it first, and then we modify the core and merge all other codes. So this way, the final user can start to use the high-level Python API, and meanwhile, we can work on the improvement of the core functionality. Okay. So the software sustainability is not only, well, it's hard to tell, but I think it's pretty important to use the advantage of the modern architectures, and especially if you have a problem which takes lots of time to compute, and if you can take advantage of the current architectures, I think like you have to do it. So nowadays, majority of the modern CPUs, mics, and all GPU accelerators take benefits of the simple arrays, like basically array of your doubles, for two reasons, like cache layouts and vectorization. However, the Titan was using a linked list of the objects, and basically we want to switch it. I got it. So the call frame, like, so basically, okay, anyway. Well, the cool point is that we switch from the structure, from the arrays of structures to the structure of arrays using encapsulation. We replace all these things and then change the data layout underneath, and we gain like a pretty nice performance. And now we're ready to migrate to the mics, PHYs, and all the GPUs.
And Nikolai has offered me the opportunity to warn the rest of the speakers that if you start to run over 5 minutes, I approach, and then you get a hug around 5 minutes and 35 seconds. So for most of you, this is a persuades people up to stop. Not for everyone. Is that you? Okay. That's your button.
My timer. So is my mic working? Yes, good. All right, so hi, my name's Abby. I work for the Mozilla Science Lab. This talk is Collaborative Software as Sustainable Software Lessons from Open Source. And at the Science Lab, we're helping researchers leverage the open web. And a big way we're doing that is through open source, both as a tool that they can use, but also as a learning experience. So open source, definition. At Mozilla, we think that open source is both public and participatory. This doesn't mean just writing software then making it free for everyone to use, but making software and inviting people to help you with it. And making this an experience where people can learn. So I noticed we had a lot of like training stuff back there. There wasn't a lot of sticky notes when I looked last, but now there are. But this is our way of saying this is how we train people, through giving them the opportunities to learn by making or learn by doing. So for the public side, if we're really if we're focusing on making things both public and participatory, these are the kind of things that we'll get. So if it's public, a public code on GitHub, Bitbucket, public discussions, issues, mailing lists, forums, public process, pull requests, open review, and an open license. So this sort of makes everything transparent, and you can see what's going on. And especially with the pull request and open review, this is a good way people learn. So they can learn what they to do with their code, how to be better. But what I'm really interested in is the participatory section. So if we are structuring our open source projects to help new people come on, we will have better documentation, a better README, so people know where they can step in. We'll have a roadmap. So this is this addresses something a little bit from the keynote, but just in open source projects, a lot of times it's community driven. So you put together a roadmap from what the community wants to do. I know it's not always possible with funders and different things, but you let the community decide what to do and then you write it down in the roadmap. I have contributing docs. And then I'd also add that I missed here a code of conduct, so people know how to participate in this community. So trying to make it accessible, I know it won't be for everyone, but also, bring people in. Then learning experiences. So I think that also ties in with what was spoken in the keynote. Just, I know that's a big thing in open source now today, people giving free labor. So this way, they are getting learning experience. They are being trained. They might come here for mentorship. They might come here because they want to learn a new language or they want to try something new. They might come because they're really interested in the project or that they use the software and they're itching a little scratch that they want a new feature. So they do get stuff out of it. I know it's not everyone can participate in open source with their time, but it's not completely free labor. They'll get something. And things like code review as mentorship, good first bugs, are a common practice in open source, just to identify some issues that are really easier to jump into, and then mentor people to go through those. So to help people who are new to this truly understand and be part of the open source community. So I made this slide before we had the discussion on what is sustainable. I will admit that I don't quite know what sustainable means in this case. But if we are focusing on making things public and participatory, we do get things that are higher quality because more eyes are on that, bugs get fixed faster, people learn from their mistakes through code review. We do have things that are reusable with the open licenses since many people are using it. And it's more understandable since we're framing everything in a way that newcomers will really understand and how to come in, then people will understand how this project works, how they can be a part of this. So a lot of this we've been documenting in this working open guide that we're putting together at Mozilla. And this is, you can go to this URL and play around with stuff. I realize this is a PDF, so I can't go and show you guys things. But we are trying to put together everything that we think a project lead needs to know to be able to facilitate their community and be a mentor to this community and really teach people how to walk through. So it's very much a work in progress. So this is also open source. And you can click edit and add your suggestions. I think that's my last slide. I have a few more seconds, so I'm going to also say today we launched something unrelated to this, but still related to you guys. We did launch our contribution badges for science, so as a way of like the alternate credit. I forget where that was standing. But now, so you know when you have a lot of authors on a paper, we're issuing badges to authors saying, like, this person wrote software, this person wrote the paper, the words, this person did data analysis, this person did visualization. So you can see that on BMC, on GigaScience, and Ubiquity Press has it, and ORCID also did that. So those are my two subjects. Thank you so much.
Had two topics that were merged into one, and she still managed to get 10 minutes for that merger, so the two fives together. She must be on the organizing committee. So 10 minutes, I'll set that for 10 for you. That's your...
Thank you very much. Yeah, Louise Kellogg couldn't be here today, and she wanted to talk to you a little bit about what we're actually doing in the terms of supporting our software at CIG. I think we actually have some cases that are applicable applicable to what some of the previous presenters were talking about. And another project we're running as part of, in conjunction with CIG, and that we're running actually with social scientists and with the university library, looking at software attribution for geoscience applications, and that's with my co-authors Joe Duman, Allison Fish, Mackenzie Smith, and Laura Soto, as well as Louise Kellogg. So I've used the word we a lot here. I've gone the wrong way. We are not Mozilla. We are CIG, and I think I have up to now three people in the room who know who CIG is. We are the Computational Infrastructure for Geodynamics. It's a whole mouthful, but what we do is we are a community-driven organization that advances earth sciences by developing and disseminating software for geophysics and related fields. That is, our science applications support research in mantle convection, lithospheric and crustal deformation, planetary dynamos, magma migration, and fluid migration through the crust. Keep on going the wrong way. So who are we? We are a group of users, and we call them user developers. That is, we're domain scientists who become really, really good software developers, and we work in collaboration with computational scientists to support some of our very large-scale complex numerical codes. These codes, these large codes, are primarily finite element or spectral element type methods codes, and they're supported typically either, actually, there is really no typical. A whole range from hero developers or small group developers to really large scale community projects. And these developers are, as well as our users, are worldwide. So we have quite of a challenge coordinating, you know, anything like conference calls and user group meetings across the time zones. What we try to do is we try to promote good stewardship of community resources. And I put a couple of buzzwords up here, and this is before these whole conversations started, when we can frame it in terms of usability, sustainability, and reproducibility. And we could spend a whole cocktail hour and still not agree about what these three words mean. But I think someone in the audience had pointed out is what these three words probably mean is more important is what it means to your user community. In that respect, one of the things we do for our community is we support our communities in a variety of ways. So we support our communities through mailing lists. This is where people can post issues and get help from other people in the community. We also have wikis in which people, we post our roadmaps for our software as well as benchmarks for our software. We also coordinate and collaborate with other organizations to provide training events. And these include workshops, which I'm gonna diverge a little bit from, and tutorials, and compare and contrast with hackathons. That is, that our workshops and tutorials are very user-focused, while our hackathons really focus on the developer communities. And there's a lot of good lessons learned there from the training perspective. So if anybody wants to come up, talk to me a little bit more about that, I'm really willing to share what we've learned from running actually now two hackathons with one of our codes. And these events all target early career researchers. And for our community, our early career researchers are graduate students and postdocs. And we also facilitate access to high-performance computing. That is, we maintain a small allocation for our community on Exceed for testing and code development. We also coordinate code performance and accuracy benchmarks exercises. We just completed a big one for our GeoDynamo community. So one of the things we actually sat down last year and did through our science steering committee is we actually wrote down what we are doing as far as our software practices and where we hope to go with them. And I have to apologize for the slide right away that it's not very readable. But if you want to actually know the details, this is a high-level table. Please go to our website and pull down developer best practices. And what you're supposed to really get out of this slide is that what we've done is we've categorized our software standards sort of in three categories. That is, there's a minimum standard, a standard standard, and a target standard. That is, all codes that we actually host in our GitHub repository must meet the minimum standards. That is, any code that we're supporting must meet our standard standards. And we're trying to move the whole community towards these target standards. That is our ideal. And we also we put them under seven different categories. That is, if you're going to deposit in our repository, you must have an open source license, you must have version control, And basically, we want you to write good code. We want to be able to build it. We want to be able to make sure it runs and runs properly with some sort of testing suite. Can I use it? Please give us some sort of documentation. But and is it easy to use? So you know, help us out here a little bit on workflows. Don't make your users struggle to use your code. So one of the things we state in our best practices is that we want everybody, if you're giving us your code, you must give us something citable. We call it, quote unquote, a citable paper. And the question is are we following our best practices? We have a sort of feel of what we're doing, but we never really sat down and actually counted and really examined what people are doing. So what most commonly it turns out what people are doing is they're asking people to cite a science paper using the code. Okay, that tends to be the most common, I think, across many scientists. A little less common is asking people, users to cite a paper on the code. Some of our developers ask people to cite the user manuals. Every so often you'll see, you know, please mention this website and or some additional attributions. What's also interesting is that we actually had 14 of our codes that had actually no citation information at all. And these tended to be archived or legacy codes. So we actually have sunsetted some codes, and there's some codes that have sort of end of life cycle in this archive. There are variants, that is, there's some softwares that are related to other more active software packages. There's a whole group of, I don't even know how to classify. And we actually found one that's one attribution that is out and out missing, so we're trying to strong arm the developers in providing that. So that answers the question of what are our developers asking our community to cite. The ancillary to that question is what is our community actually doing? So I found myself, after writing this huge long report last year, with a big list of actual publications that use SIG codes. And I'll admit right off the bat that this list is extremely biased. So this is a self-reported list. It's a list of papers that I actually could search on the web for. And there were about 300 papers. And of these 300 papers, a code by name was mentioned perhaps like 500 times. If we look at how many times a version number was included with that, it was like 13%. About 21% included a URL, and not that many people actually mentioned licensing at all. So this includes both CIG codes, commercial and other open source codes. So we dial this back a little bit and look just at CIG codes, what people are doing as far as citing our software. We find that of this population of papers, at least 83% of them mention a CIG code. Some of them mention multiple CIG codes. And when they're mentioning CIG codes, they will cite something 75% of the time. About maybe 10% fewer actually cites the preferable publications. And then about 19% actually acknowledge is CIG. If we take a step back a little bit here, the Venn diagram on the right is supposed to remind me that even if we look at a population of codes, if we look at it in terms of maybe attributes we think that represent reproducibility or attributes that represent attribution or credit, that no one paper actually really cites everything. That is, people cite one or two of these attributes, but no one actually cites them all. We also sort of learned to sort of, you know, by observation, it's not quantified at all, that people learn by example. That is, people learn from their research group and they learn from reading other papers. That is, if there is a code that's commonly cited, other people will commonly cite that code as well. If there are references that are commonly cited or style of referencing, people tends to show up again and again. So one of the things we were trying to do is to help people along is to provide them an example. That is, we're in the process of refining some boilerplate language for people to use to aid in attributions. And perhaps some of this information can be placed in the text, some in the acknowledgments, and some in the references. There are still some unanswered questions here. That is, what is citable, who should be cited, and what is a persistent archive? So there are a couple of things we're trying to do through our site, SAGA project, is that Some of them is pretty easy. That is, provide some standardized language on our website. It turns out a lot of this information is somewhere on our website, but there is no one place. So it's a little difficult for people to find. So one of the things we're going to do is in our software summary box there, which you have the status of our software summarized, is also provide a link to a citation for people to use. Two other elements we're trying to incorporate in this project is to try to develop some sort of plugin for the software. We don't think this is too difficult, but we also need, we anticipate in the future we need to, address issues in transitive credit and another metadata people might want to do to promote reproducibility. Thank you.
For some people, it's not a deterrent.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lorraine. Could you give that to John? That was wonderful.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. See if I've. Yes, clip it. Yes.
Mirek Nabrzyski, Notre Dame. Thank you for accepting our paper, even though we didn't probably mention even the word sustainability. But I thought this project is very relevant. So DASPOS is an SF-funded project. Actually, a couple of years ago, a bunch of hydrogen physicists came to us, computer scientists, and asked us a question: what can we do to preserve our science, to preserve our data, you know, petadata, data, right? To preserve our methods, our software. And we basically said, we have no idea. Let's go and ask the librarians. And this is how this collaboration started, you know, a collaboration that today includes, you know, hydrogen physicists, computer scientists, and librarians in various institutions. The idea of the project is really to investigate various methods of data and software preservation. So what can we really do to preserve software and data, not only when it's sustainable or sustained, but even beyond its sustainability scale? What if someone wants to repeat our experiments in the future? Will they be able to, you know, rerun these experiments using the data from, you know, 20 years ago and using the software methods that we developed today? So this is the project, and we are 3 years out. What we do is we really develop software. We develop preservation software. We try to outreach to various communities, so we not only work with hydrogen physicists, but through a series of workshops, we also you know, engage some other communities and kind of look at what these communities are doing. The software that we develop is a software for preservation. So really, you know, a few software packages, some of them are part of Ben mentioned the CCL lab run by Doug Thane. So this first software packages, Umbrella and Prune, the first one for creating a reproducible environment, and Prune, which is, you know, kind of a Git for workflows. And then we also do some smart container, which is adding provenance and ontologies to Docker-like containers. We do also some other science reproducibility tools. And the question for us is, you know, can this software be sustained, right? Can we develop this software so it sustains, you know, these various generations? In our case, it's maybe easier because we work very closely with policy makers for hydrogen physics. We work with DPHEP. And these guys may say, okay, guys, physicists, use this software. But of course, if this software puts another, you know, burden on scientists' backs, they won't use it, right? If it's too much effort for them, they won't use this software. Because even if the policies say use it, they say no. I mean, it's impossible to really use software that is not usable and adds so much to our day-to-day duties. So I think, you know, some thoughts on sustainability. I think it's really very important that you work closely with your user community, and you listen to their requirements, and you know, deliver a software that supports their mission. One more remark, maybe on the because I still have 1 minute, on the definition of sustainability. I was kind of thinking about it as well, and I thought maybe I believe it's impossible to really define sustainability in one definition, but maybe it would be possible to define, to design an index that would take all of these different aspects of sustainability that Mark was talking about in his keynote, and kind of, you know, build one index that would fit various needs. And of course, depending on who we are, how we want to use sustainability, would put different criteria and weights on different aspects of sustainability. But again, I don't believe, so this is very similar how people created, you know, indexes for environmental sustainability, for example, or other kind of sustainability. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay. So, you know, for me, it's not about sustainability, it's about making computationally based research less rubbish. We think that sustainability is one of the things that will help with that. The problems facing research software are well known, and much of our software is standard of correctness, is the graph looks about right, and we never use each other's stuff. We've been trying to fix that for a long time, and lots of us have perpetrated middleware in our time and done similar things like that. You know, we've tried to find technical solutions to these problems, and my worry is that these have resulted in publications in computer science journals, but they haven't changed science. And I think we need to do something differently. So we think we need social solutions to the technical problems that are faced by computationally based research. And we hypothesize that we need to create a new role in the academic ecosystem to address the questions of making research software. The research software engineer. My name's James, and I'm a research software engineer. Hello. You know, we think that this is important to combine the best of the craftsperson and the scholar, the engineers who value themselves on the code that they've made, but also very much part of the research ecosystem as well. But we know that social innovation in centuries-old institutions is really, really hard. Lots of other people have been trying to fix this a different way, by hacking things so that we can prosper in our traditional academic careers and still work well on creating good software, by changing the recognition systems and that kind of thing, even perhaps through funder mandates. I'm extremely skeptical about whether any of this line will work. I'd be delighted if it did. But we think that it's time to say, no, let's just have some people and call them research software engineers and measure them differently and give them a new home in the academic ecosystem. We think that having groups of research software engineers in universities, and I think it's important to emphasize we're talking about in universities here, there have been people with research software engineer roles in national labs for a long time, but most research software sits in that long tail of stuff that's written in groups in universities around the planet. We think the advantage of having RSE groups in universities is, one, it's somebody to teach that course on good software engineering skills for scientists that all starting grad students need. Who's going to teach that? It's going to have to be the research software engineers. It's also good to have division of labor, right? Division of labor is a fantastic idea. Let's have a bit more of that. Let's have team-based science with groups coming together. I don't think this is just for software either. I think we need more of this for all the other different sets of skills that work together to 21st century research. It's also useful to have these groups because it creates synergies with all of the energy and money that funders are spending on research computing platforms. If you build a supercomputer, it's quite useful to have somebody who can help make some code to run on it. I used to know the person who used the biggest UK GPU platform. He was the user because he was the only person who knew how to get that code to work there. So that's another advantage of having it. So a research software group, I've got 2 minutes left, collaborates with researchers to build sustainable software, delivers teaching and reproducible consequences of research. I'm just going to stop reading the slide out now. One interesting question is, where do you put it, right? My group is formally constituted as part of UCL Research IT Services, which is part of the IT department. That's not fantastic. I have to have an honorary lectureship as well so that researchers don't think I'm a boring IT guy. But it's an interesting question as to how institutions will build this place fitting with the particular culture of that institution. We're going to learn more about that as time goes, but we're starting to see these groups really, really grow in the UK. We started 3 years ago. There was a Software Sustainability Institute workshop. We decided what to call ourselves. We decided to go for research software engineer, and everyone started using that, and this is now a term that's repeatedly used in job adverts in jobs.ac.uk, which is a fantastic victory for our thing. We went over lots of other titles, but we've stuck to one so we can all say, I'm a research software engineer. I created the UCL Research Software Group in September 2012. The SSI began campaigning on this. Over the time since then, my group has grown through collaborating with researchers to get, oh, I'd like 20% of a research software engineer on my grant, please. We've grown the team to, that's a six, it's now seven. When the job advert that got posted today is filled, do apply. And we've now got groups being founded in several other UK institutions as well, Manchester, Southampton, Sheffield. So this is really spreading and becoming, I think, a normal and mainstream thing within the UK research software system. And the EPSRC have announced a fellowship, which is really exciting, to create such a group with money out of the EPSRC. Talk more to Ian if you want to know more about that. I think this is going to be really transformative to have posts that are combining, you know, that are fellowships for these hybrid both and scientist and support roles, which is really exciting. In the future, I'd like to see research software engineer groups in most research intensive universities in the UK, and would this work in other countries? I don't know. That's why I've come to this workshop. Thank you.
Everyone hear me?
Okay.
There's your clicker. There's your timer. You can slip that right in your pocket if you want.
Okay. Speaking 101. All right. So my name is Dan Gunter. My two topics can't really be merged. They're a little schizophrenic like me, I guess. I was a little surprised both things were accepted, so there you go. So the first one is going to be about bringing the user into sustainable software development for science. So I'm from Berkeley Lab. This is maybe the first DOE lab perspective you've heard. But I don't think that's going to alter the message very much for everyone. So actually, we've heard a lot about users, right? The importance of users in sustainable software. And I'd like to sort of make that's kind of the central point here of this whole talk and this slide, is that you can have great developers, good design, money, good software engineering practices, but if you don't have users, you probably don't have sustainable software. Basically, who are you writing it for, and what does it really mean if it's sustainable with no users? However, in spite of this, the process by which software is commonly built and designed doesn't really focus on the user. This is a straw person in the spirit of the keynote talk. This is the straw person of how you probably shouldn't do it, but how it's often done, is that these are the sort of the official stages on the left, and then here's what people are actually doing. Gather requirements pretty much means you go out and talk about how great your software is going to be, and the users nod their heads. Design is you design something that certainly seems interesting to you, and that should probably solve the problem as you understand it, coincidentally, the way that's the most interesting for you to program it. And then you develop and test and say, well, it works great, look at this. And then you send it to the user, and you discover that that's not at all what they wanted, is usually how it goes, if you actually haven't spoken to them at all during this process. There's certainly lots of examples from outside scientific software in which perfectly decent companies were able to make horrendous mistakes by pretty much not understanding what the users wanted. And therefore, what some of my and related people's research at LBL is involved in is doing research that actually explicitly tries to engage the user at the beginning and throughout the process. In researching the user as part of the software development process. So it's not just the R&D on the bottom, but actually engage the scientists, these chicken scientists here, in understanding what they really need in order, and have explicitly someone who's responsible for designing the user experience involved in coming up with what the final product is like. And it turns out that there are, you know, so there's a significant body of research methods that we can draw on in ethnography and actually pulling data from user, analytics of what user is doing, sort of the hard data that we sympathize more with here, that allows us to sort of change this software design. It's funny how the line changed. So this little line is just supposed to go straight back there. To take these steps and really add a software research angle so that we can actually understand through prototypes what the user wants. And so as an example of the application of this process, in our groups we have a workflow software called Tigress, in which we applied these same steps to try to design what a workflow API should really look like for people to use workflow software. As we all know, there's this huge proliferation of workflow software that largely repeats what you see in other workflow software, mostly due to the fact that no one understands how to use the previous one. And we also are developing similar ideas under the concepts of data abstractions and how to let scientists have abstractions to the data that separate them from some of these horrible sort of mutations you see in the architectures, especially when we have this huge gap between so the CPU speed and the disk speed and the modern supercomputers and clusters. Okay, so probably not doing well with time. Okay, topic two. This is more of a use case. It's a large project I'm involved in for how do you do sustainable software at scale in sort of a lab research environment. The name of the project is KBase. That's a DOE Systems Biology Knowledge Base. It's a multi-million dollar project from the Basic Energy Research. This has very ambitious goals about designing a system and a platform for many, many biologists to get together and predict biological function. The system actually needs to be building, though, a bunch of software in the end. I mean, there's all these grand aspirations about biology, but before that we can get there, we've got to build a platform. So the real challenge is we've got these institutions, which are large institutions, all with their own traditions of working sort of within the institution, but working across them. We've got quite a few people involved that we have to coordinate in order to get this software together. And it's a real challenge to get everyone involved here to pull together to make a sustainable system. So here's some things that don't work. Working in isolation, having groups go off in a corner and do their own thing and then present the results to the rest of the people is something fait accompli. No, doesn't work. Taking something that just exists and continuing to hack it because, hey, I invented it. It looks like it could be adapted for this other use case. Let's try that. Also doesn't work. And of course, not having any standards across this large group for software engineering, because getting 50 people to agree on anything is very difficult without a single dictator. Is not effective as well. So of course, the standard reaction should be, yeah. And why would you think that does work? Well, if you think about it, if you're kind of in a small CS research group, that kind of describes a lot of the practices you do, because you're saving time in the short run and for highly rewarded activities like publishing your results and quickly pushing out a bunch of new software that has some feature in it. And then the student's going to graduate, and well, you'll have to rewrite it later, but that's not the concern for the highly rewarded activity. So it's a reward system question within a research environment that doesn't translate very well to something you're going to have running across a production environment. So what we're trying to do in this project is to actually take all these ideas from agile software development that we all like to talk about. We're going to get together and do scrums and sprints and all that thing, and actually try to apply this across four or five agile teams working in parallel on this cycle of 2 week sprints to get something done, then an evaluation with a sort of project-wide committee, then picking new sprints and prioritizing them and feeding this back into the cycle. This, for us at least, in industry this may not be new, but certainly within this kind of collaboration, completely new process. And so we've done a lot of work, and we've got a Jira that's trying to coordinate it. We're using GitHub with way, way too many software repos that we're trying to get down to a relatively small number. If you go to the github.kbase, you'll see what I mean. But the important thing is that we've also combined this with an openness of the process. And so what we're trying to do is have a set of project guides that sort of describe across the project how we're doing this and get everyone to at least be able to have some transparency to what's going on, which has been really a key aspect that was sort of missing in some of the early collaboration on this project, was that people didn't even know the process by which other people were operating. So there, if you want to talk to me about that, that's my use case, I think. Whoops. I finished both of them ahead of time. Thank you. Yes.
Before we hear from Aaron, we're going to take 1 minute, and in an ideal world, the one in which I live, you have a handful of post-its in front of you that are cluttering up your mind and your space. And take a minute now and put those where they belong. And if you don't have any, can you make one up now? Put it up there. So just 1 minute before we hear from Aaron, and post any post-its that you created, or create one now. And then we'll pick it up and finish these lightning talks. Another 30 seconds, get those post-its up.
It's a lot of, my hands are full. No, because I don't know where to hook it. Great. Well, thank you very much. My name is Erin Robinson. I'm the executive director at the Foundation for Earth Science, and I'm here on behalf of my collaborators for the OntoSoft project, in particular, Professor Yolanda Gill, who's the PI of our project and couldn't be here. So OntoSoft is two things. One, it's a software repository that makes it easy for people to document their software for reuse. And the other is it's a set of training materials to train people to do that process. And so the people that we were really targeting the training towards are these people in the upper right corner. So these are our early career advisory board. They come from across the domain scientists, and one of the things that we really like about them is that while they're scientists, they're real scientists, they're also developing code, and they have issues with that code. So they came in to provide guidance to our project, but it turned out that they've really taken our project in a different direction, called this Geoscience Paper of the Future that I'm going to talk about. So I'm not saying that anybody's workspace looks like this, but this photo really gets to the pain points that this early career advisory panel talked to us about, that when they tried to write a paper, that their code was in one place, their data was somewhere else, maybe it was on, you know, on CDs, God forbid. Their lab notebooks were, you know, everywhere. They pulled it all together for a paper, but there really wasn't a lot of linkage back in the paper to these artifacts.
And I use this picture of hurdles a lot. And normally I mean that there are hurdles to, when you are looking at the paper, to finding the data, to accessing it, to understanding how good it is. But when I was thinking about telling this story today about the Early Career Advisory Panel, really one of the big hurdles for them was, how do you add this training onto an already full career load where you know that you need to document your data, you know you need to document your code, you know you need to write papers in these cleaner ways, but you don't know how. So that, I think, is the biggest hurdle that we've seen with this group. So in came this idea of the geoscience paper of the future. And I'm using my crib notes. And I really would like to thank Abby and Lorraine, because I feel like you both set me up to talk about this in a way that I wasn't sure that we were going to make the connection here. So the geoscience paper of the future trains geoscientists to do these practices of data sharing, of open science, of things that we talk about. You know, like, I've been to a bunch of meetings on data and software citation, but when you take it to the geoscience paper of the future, you're actually learning by doing and giving people, you know, with their own papers, the way to use the citations that are included on the website, or things like that. So now's where we get a little bit fancy, because these are not my slides, so I'm jumping around. So the Early Career Advisory Group then acted as pioneers. They needed the training, but they needed it embedded in a way that they could do what they were doing for their day jobs and get something out of it. So they took their own papers. Sometimes it was papers they'd already written. Sometimes it was papers that they were planning to write. And they started going through this process with us. They devoted 2 to 4 hours a week of, you know, going through training with Yolanda and with our team of how to document their data, document their software, use GitHub repos, you know, you name it. They were really in it doing this. So now we're going to go back one. And so from that, we've been able to start to generalize. And we have a couple of really exciting things going on. So the first is that the Geoscience Papers of the Future has become a huge initiative. And it was picked up by AGU, and so there's a special issue that's accepting submissions right now, and I'll put up another slide about that, in Earth and Space Science. And then we've taken this, you know, what was weeks-long training, and we've really condensed it into basically 3 hours of training that we've been giving both in person, and so that's where Yolanda is today. She gave it at NCAR earlier, small world that it is, and she's at USGS this afternoon. And then we've been giving webinars. So this is a little more about the special issue if you're interested, and I'd encourage you all to submit. And then this is a bit more about the trainings that are coming up. So we have a bunch of in-person trainings that are coming up, JPL, UT Austin, GSA, and AGU. And then our next webinar is November 9th. And I'd say that I think the ways that this group can contribute are by helping with the training and submitting a paper.
Yay. Nice. Thank you. Neil is next. Neil?
Okay. Thank you very much. All right, can everyone hear me at the back? Excellent. All right, so I'm talking about building a scientific software accreditation framework, and I think this is something that's been touched upon in a lot of the discussion and some of the presentations that have come before. So as you'll discover from my talk, I'm really glad of this, because it means I get to steal with attribution all your ideas and use it in the pilot we're running. So what we're trying to do is understand the question of what is good software and how can we measure it? And I think this came up in Matt's presentation. We don't really understand what we mean by good in many senses. And I don't think that's because we don't understand it. It's because we have many multiple definitions. So the question is, how can we create a framework that allows for this kind of assessment And can we actually create measures that allow us to use this sort of framework? And in the UK, we've been doing something that is very relevant to this, which is nothing to do with software, and it's called food labeling. So we have these ideas of nutritional labeling, which go beyond just providing figures of calories and so on, and starts providing what we call traffic light indicators on all food packaging that's sold in the UK to give the everyday public an idea of what's in their food. And the idea is that it's a small set of categories, so this is by no means inclusive of everything you might want to measure. It gives very clear indications of what sort of broad bracketing a particular category falls within. And importantly, it's a framework that can be evaluated differently due to different community norms. So in one sense, you do not want a cake to be all green in these categories. You want it to be high in fat, you want it to be high in calories, and you don't want a healthy heart diet meal to be red in any of the categories. So you can use different community norms to use the same framework to assess whether something is good or bad. And that's where we start getting to, because when we're talking about a software accreditation framework, the biggest challenges are that a lot of measures are subjective. So if we look at something a little bit more software related, if you're in the computational chemistry community, for instance, the thing that you might be prioritizing is whether you can do a larger number of time steps or your time steps have a smaller resolution. If you're in an engineering community, you might be interested in the extensibility of a code to add in new models. So each community has its own different sets of measures that determine whether software is good or not. And also many metrics are costly to measure. So one of the biggest problems we have in our community is that we don't really have any money to measure whether we're doing the things right or wrong. And that's a bigger problem, I think, that we need to assess. And the last one is that we need to encourage this to be done through self-assessment. One of the other questions that's on the table for WSPI is, should we be cataloging things and creating catalogs? And I can say there's someone who's created free catalogs, it's really difficult to be the curator of a catalog. It's much easier if you're getting people to provide that information. For something like an assessment framework, if you don't get people to provide the information, it's not going to work. So how can we make this something that people will use because they find benefit from it, rather than something that is used because we want to judge different people's software? And so there's the problem. So what's the purpose of a software accreditation framework? Is it about enabling improvement versus enabling comparison? Are you trying to assess your own software, or is someone trying to compare your software with someone else's? And I think it would be used for both purposes. So what we've got is a pilot that's going to be running over the next few months in the UK, looking at assessing a number of existing pieces of software against a draft framework. What we'd like to be able to do is then go further and then take this out to other willing volunteers. And I've already, from the last Lightning Talks, identified a number of willing volunteers because they've been brave enough to put up similar looking things on their slides, and see where we go from there and what the community acceptance is. Because after we've done that, the next question is providing the tools that help people use a framework like this to gain benefit. And that's where the second thing that I wanted to mention comes into play, which is software management plans. So we all have an idea of data management plans and how they can be helpful for assessing and maintaining data in the long term. How can we extend this to software management plans? And so we've been building out tools that help do this on existing data management planning software. And what we'd like to understand is, how do we start working in the framework for accrediting good software, good scientific software, into those tools? So if you're interested in this, take a look at my paper or come in to speak to me at a break. And yes, we are looking for volunteers to have their software assessed using this framework. Thanks very much. 2 seconds.
So I heard Neil use the word curation. And so maybe that relates to enabling the community to find some info, that poor flip chart that has no post-its to keep it warm.
Hi, thank you. So I'm Jeff Carr from the University of Alabama. A little bit different, I think, than most of you. There's a few others out here that are true software engineers and are not scientists as well. So I come from a bit of a different perspective. So I want to give you just a little bit of my background and kind of where I'm coming from, and then give you an idea of where I think we might go. So some of you may be familiar with a workshop series that I've organized with lots of different people. Neil's been involved in these as well as others that have been held at various venues. I wouldn't say it's a competing with this one. It's quite a different orthogonal perspective of trying to look at how can software engineering principles be applied appropriately in science. And I'll come back to that in a minute. But we do have another one coming up at Supercomputing. So if any of you happen to be there and would like to drop by, we'd love to have more people there. I've also done a number of case studies, relatively small case studies of scientific software development teams where I had students of mine actually go become part of a team or work closely with the team in a couple different areas, and I'm not going to go into much detail. I can talk about these later with folks if they're interested, but we did some with peer code review, and I had a student actually go spend a significant amount of time with a team working on test-driven development and trying to apply that in a scientific environment, and it worked out pretty well. And the third piece of data that I have as a background is I've done a number of surveys of various people in the scientific software community. Some of you may have been asked to be guinea pigs if you happen to be on an email list that I had access to. So a lot of data from that as well. But what I want to say is, going into all of this, my basic assumption in coming to this and wanting to talk about sustainability from this perspective is that the use of appropriate software engineering practices leads to more sustainable software. And the key word there is appropriate. So I've interacted with lots of scientists and lots of scientific teams whose experience with software engineer has been somebody walks in with a big book of process and drops it on the desk and says, do all this and you'll be fine. That doesn't work. So the key word is appropriate. And going forward, that's an important thing. And we need to know what appropriate means. We need to know what that looks like. And we need to know what's not appropriate. So a lot of the things that have been discussed here today, I think, are great. And as I mentioned in my intro this morning, I'm an empirical software engineer, which means I like to gather data to make sure things are actually working. And I also mentioned human factors. So I'm focused more on, are things working for people, the people that have to do these things? So with that, let me give you a couple of observations, and then I'll finish up with some directions I think could be helpful going forward. So a couple of things that I think are interesting, as I've worked with various software engineering and scientist groups, there's a culture clash. And again, this may not be new to most of you, but it's both in terms of language and terminology, but also cultures and what's expected. We've heard a lot about what's valued, what's not valued. It's an important thing. How do we get people to recognize the value of software engineering? And again, it's not software engineering for the sake of software engineering. It's software engineering for the sake of building software that can be sustained and maintained over the long term. One of the things that we found interesting from a survey that we did was that many scientific software developers really don't know what they don't know. A lot of people thought they were very competent and knew everything they needed to, and then when we started to drill down into some of the specific details, it really turned out they were unaware of lots of things that could have helped some of the problems. So that was an interesting observation. So as I mentioned a second ago, appropriate software engineering practices are useful. You know, lightweight processes, not these heavyweight things that are you know, going to really get in the way. Test-driven development, appropriately tailored. We have an example of that I could talk more about, but it's not the pure test-driven development that you might see in a you know, software engineering textbook, but tailored to work in an environment. Same thing with peer code review. In our specific example, we had some anecdotal evidence that the teams told us. We did some peer code review, and we found problems that we never would have found testing. We wouldn't have tested for that particular situation, but it was a key problem. And one other interesting side note from that one is that this team actually, on their own, started using a coding standard. They weren't using one. I didn't tell them to use one, but as soon as they started reviewing each other's code, they said, hey, we need a coding standard. And that's going to turn out to make the code more sustainable in the long run. So a couple quick thoughts on my thoughts of a path forward before I run out of time here. I think we need more documented success stories of applying software engineering practices in science. One of the biggest things I hear from scientific teams is, that's great, that works over in the business IT world, but we don't look like them. So we need more things that are documented that look like them, so we can try to get these things out there. We also need to socialize these, and I already mentioned the first venue of the workshop series, and the second one, this one hasn't really been publicized yet, you'll probably be hearing more about it, but there's a new software engineering track in the CISE magazine. I'm one of the co-editors of that track, so hopefully we'll also have the ability to put some interesting experiences out there as well. Thank you.
Just one quick thing. Before, Neil, I saw that you have your slide on Figshare. I hope you don't have a password which is sensitive. They are aware since last November that their password authentication mechanism is broken and that password can be stolen, and still haven't done anything with that. So you should probably change all your other password. Otherwise, when this is done, let's continue. So hi, I'm Matthias. I'm from UC Berkeley. I am, like many of you, I am an open source maintainer, and I have many questions on how users are using my software, and how many people use my software, which frequency, which version, which API are used and not used, on which OS, and all those kind of things. And it's really difficult to have metrics for that. And with colleagues at Berkeley and around, we look at what the current solution is. And the current solution usually is you send something on the mailing list on Twitter, you look at download count, you make a survey, and you try to extrapolate how many users have Linux installed, how many users install Popcorn, and then how many users have your software, and you try to get a count. But you're still not sure that your software is used. One thing you can do, which is a bit breaking user trust, is to actually, when your library is imported, make a network request and log some data on the server. I don't really like that. And it's hard to ask a user, do you allow me to collect data if you're on a library like Blass or like NumPy, which is really, really low level. You don't want to reinvent your project for everything for each project, and you might have legal issues, more bugs, more maintenance, all these issues. Fortunately, I work on a user-facing project, so it's easy for me to have dialog box, and we decided that actually we can do something by taking inspiration from Mozilla telemetry. We have that with Firefox. Firefox prompts you, can I collect data? And they send things to Mozilla that publicize what they called telemetry, which show you which users are using Firefox, how, and they have really deep metric. And the idea is basically to create one library that someone I work with have done on GitHub. It's still in working progress, that provides two APIs. One for user-facing project that basically will ask user once and for all, do you allow us to collect data? Yes, no. And that can set a global flag, yes, I allow you to collect data on the behalf of underlying libraries. And like convenient method, like get a license in different language, explanation, links to websites that tells you how to do that. And for programmers that do underlying libraries, they can just require this library and drop small calls like count the number of time I do this function, or call the number of times this function is imported. And then once a client's facing project run, every now and then what will happen is you will collect the results and post them if the user has accepted the data collection. Of course, then the data collection is on a neutral third party. We are thinking about speaking with NumFocus, which would take care of all the legal issues and store the data on the cloud, publish only aggregated statistics, so that you don't have leakage of user personal information, and only possibly white lists of information at the beginning, like only few projects are public and everything. And this would allow us to get a lot of actual quantitative results, like for funding agencies, how much the funding did for improving the adoption of the project, or how did you improve. You could also improve deprecation cycle. If you know that someone is not using a specific API, you can just drop it faster and then focus the resource of your project on the library that you, on the part of the library you want to the user are using. Or things like more tricky, like how do you know whether users know if a new feature exists, and oftentimes you have sat somewhere in the documentation, but if the documentation cannot be found, you will see that you have no new usage of these features. There are still a lot of questions around that. The project has started as a sprint last SciPy, and it's on GitHub, and there is also a mailing list which is on the GitHub README. If you want to join, if you're interested and you want to push that forward to basically know how your project is used, which version of Python is used and everything, please come talk to me. Thank you.
Give that clicker to Alex.
I can't talk for only 5 minutes unless I have strict notes to guide me, so I'm sorry about that. Okay, I'm Alice Allen with the Astrophysics Source Code Library, which is an online registry of source codes that have been used in refereed research. You can find it at ASCL.net. Our goal is to make research more transparent by making the software more discoverable for examination. We also support software reuse, and we advocate strongly for better citation of software. So one of the questions I have is, what good is sustainable software if nobody can find it? So one of the things we want to do is make software more discoverable for astrophysics, and a software code registry or repository can increase discoverability, and in the ASCL's case, has helped make codes more citable. So we assign a unique ID to codes. Some researchers are using this identifier to ask people to cite their code, and that is happening. We're indexed by the major indexing service for astrophysics, the Astrophysics Data System, or ADS. So Astro Journals are accepting citations to ASCL IDs. Over 17% of ASCL entries have been cited in papers. That's up from 7.5% just in January of last year. Most software is cited by a paper, not by the ASCL entry, but we are seeing a lot of uptake of this. So though the ASCL is mainly an indexing, it can and does also serve as a repository for some software. So what I'm offering today is a clone of the ASCL infrastructure for anybody who wants to build their own software repository or registry. It's very lightweight. So if you want to build your own, you can take our infrastructure, configure it however you'd like, change it however you'd like. We will even host it for you for free. And we'll provide the server space, computing resources at Michigan Technological University, which is the home of the ASCL. We will share anything that we change on the ASCL with you so you can adopt it or not. And we'll let you move your site anywhere else with the data intact should you want to do that, because it's your site. So it doesn't have to be housed at Michigan Tech. You can house it wherever you house this cloned infrastructure anywhere you'd like. So what we would ask you to do is to provide the domain name, pay for that, take control of the site and configure it for your own use, however you want it to be. Use the site as intended, so gather or collect codes however you'd like, whether through crowdsourcing, editor searching, automated literature searches, scraping, or any combination thereof. Share anything that you change with the ASCL and with anyone else who takes us up on this offer. And protect the computing environment at Michigan Tech. Don't do anything that's harmful. And I'm not putting it up there as a bullet point, but please be kind about the programming, because the person who volunteered to create our system is a volunteer. She's not trained, like almost every scientist who's afraid to let his or her code go out because it's messy. She's afraid that her code is messy, but she's going to share it anyway. So our infrastructure is built all on open source software. We use MySQL for the database. We use WordPress for content management, PHPBB for a discussion forum, and CodeIgniter for the development framework. You wouldn't have to use all of those. We would provide these to you, and then whatever you wanted to use would be up to you. And if you're interested, see me here or contact me via email, editor@ASCL.networks, aallen@ASCL.networks. .net also works. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Ray. I see a lot of the other authors in the audience too. I'm going to talk about developing scientific software success metrics while developing community. The background for this work is a February workshop at the NSF SI2PI workshop, which is Software Infrastructure for Sustained Innovation. And they're one of the breakout teams, breakout groups addressed the framework for the creation of metrics. So it basically was to define software success metrics across different research domains. So the idea is to improve both the metrics and the software at the same time, where stakeholders contribute their software, and this concurrently generates metrics to go along with that. And all the while doing this, building community, so improving the crosstalk among different research domains about what makes software successful. So a key idea that came out of this is the software peer review group. Okay, so that's representative stakeholders who can evaluate the software and can also contribute their software for inclusion. But it is, with that said, it's important to say that this is a community, we see this as a community governed effort. So no single institution should put this forward. So it's really important that there's not necessarily a core group of experts from a single institution, but rather that the stakeholders are in the community, the core group of experts are spanning the community, and the community is always growing with this idea. And the hope is that out of this would come software metrics that the community can adopt as community standards. So part of the framework, what we see is that there's an awful lot of software that you all are working on, and you know the community, the scientific software community at large. So the incentive for them to contribute their software is for them to get back what could improve their software. So in the start, you know, it might take a core group of people to kind of seed this and get this going. But when, you know, maybe it's the initial people who are behind this effort or contributing their own software. But once this seeding process is going, and hopefully this open source engine is going, open community engine, then more and more people will start to partake of it. The metrics will start to, you know, take shape. We'll sort of know how to apply them, know what metrics work. And we also want to know what makes, you know, if we're starting to size up what makes scientific software successful, we're also presumably getting an angle on what causes it to not be successful. Some infrastructure support, we'd need code and code review infrastructure, but we also want to respect that the code and code review infrastructure that others are using, that they should be able to continue to use that while we put these evaluation methods in place. It's important to have a social framework, so to get that social angle going where people can constantly comment on the metrics, to refine them, to refine the language, to refine the approach, to refine the method, and so forth. And another idea that came from the breakout group is, can we fit all of these metrics into a common template? So the work just thus far is, we wrote a 2-page white paper, which is great because, you know, a lot of times we say we're going to write a white paper. So somewhere between that PI workshop and now, we've managed to put a 2-page white paper together. We're submitting it to, I don't know if this is the right way to say this, but CISPE. It's got WISPE and CISPE, okay. But Gabriel Allen is one of the co-organizers for that. And we'll be posting the white paper later this week. And also, you know, part of one of the co-authors on this work was Neil, and he's part of the organizing committee here, and he said, hey, you should, you know, think about submitting this work to WISPE. So, you know, we have, from the PI workshop, we have a lot of, in the Google Docs, we have a lot of example of what these metrics could be. So we've got a good working mass of metrics to kind of proceed forward with. And so what we're hoping to use WISPE for is a forum for the community to assemble and act. It's one of the things that WISPE said would be good for this. So next steps, we want to use these types of WISPE and CISPE and things like this to continually build the community, take advantage of these venues, and collaborate with other metrics and framework activities. So since I'm the last lightning talker, I know you are, and you know who I am. And then consider a proposal around this. That was one of the feedback when we submitted this work. One of the feedback was he had to consider a proposal. So, and one of them even said consider an interagency proposal. So You know, again, this is about the framework. So if there's a good community behind it, a strong community, a community where they clearly state there's a need for this, and there's just a lot of force with that, that of course carries a lot of weight in getting funding. And, you know, whether we lead it or part of it, or, you know, it has, however it manifests, I think it's important to move forward. Okay.